Thank you very much. And thank you very much for organizers for giving me an opportunity to the next conference. So I will talk about... Luminous transient by mass ejection from very massive stars to persistent nuclear instability. So my talk is based on this output. So collaborators are Hideki Umeda, Keiichi Yamaeda, and Kato Ishii. So, Alex talked about mainly the evolution of normal massive stars and K-Felix stars. So my topic is between the mass range of these super. So massive stars with super mass is about 35 to 6 solar mass experience persistent pair instability by electron proton pair creations. So and this mainly don't consider masses, the corresponding the main secret mass is around this region. So, talking about pair instability, if the pair instability works very well, star contracts with hydrodynamical time scale rather than hydrostatic time scale. So, as a result, the star burns. Encounter the oxygen system burning with a very short time scale and whole star is exploded. But in this region, the energy generation of the oxygen burning and super burning is not so large. So the star expands but not explode. So as a result, star pulsates like this. So finally, process and so in this stage, eruptive mass loss and luminous transient are investigated by these forces. So on the other hand, recently, some very massive stars, very massive stars indicating the massive stars with initial mass of heavier than 100 solar mass will be found in metal core star forming regions. So this is the observational evidence and the slow evolution calculations by Geneva group. So about 200 to 300 solar mass stars have been observed. So if some of these stars encounter less mass loss and less mass loss, these stars could become persistent instability. So the observation of supernova explosions, observers also the superluminous supernovae start of the type 1C and including supernova R with greatly long time scale of long time scale corresponding to the cobalt 56 of the division and mostly decline. So this supernova origin has not been verified and some candidate has been discussed, mainly bounding bells and CF interactions. And for supernova R, supernova could be possible, and for supernova could be possible. And for the, even before the supernova explosions, some bright optical transients have been observed. So in this case, 2 years. This one they have been found before two years before the explosions. So this phenomenon could be related to the eruptive muscles. So in this study, We induce eruptive muscles of very massive blood induced by a pulsation of electricity and the vital cup events. So we have created three cases of stars, 140 and 250 cells. It is the metallicity around SMC. So So we calculate star pulsation on eruptive muscles using star pulsation mode and hypothalamus mode. Then we also calculate the supernova explosions, assuming spherical synchronous supernova explosions for synchronicity. So finally, we investigate light curves based in the interactions between muscle cells and supernova. So this is an example of the results. So the case of 140 solar mass star. So this star evolved to 50.4.1 solar mass star before pulsation appears to be. So this is the time sequence of the central temperature. And we see six pulsations in this star. So in each pulsation, and we see muscles like this. So during the evolutions, there must be induced 50.1 to 50. And at the same time, the such layer has lost, and the such same mass fraction also changes from 0.19 to 0.045. So we also show that Swiss mass models result like this. So in the 140 solar mass, this is six pulsations. And in case of 200 solar mass model, we see four pulsations. And for 250 solar mass space, we see three pulsations. So the time scale completely different. So 1 year and around 20 years and 1500 years, 1500 years. So pulsation period and pulsation number depends on the mass scale, star mass. So it changes like year to 10 to 30 years. Yeah, and more detailed study has been done in Lusignan Taylor 2014 in the text of evolution of very massive stars. So in their studies, less massive stars encounter many pulses, more pulses, and shorter time scale. So then we calculate the supernova explosion simply. So here is the result and as a function of initial mass and the ejector mass and so on. So here is the supernova mass. And when we assume the explosion energy is normal supernova, ejected mass is very small compared to the supernova mass. And only outermost tensor mass region. As a dead force, and we don't see any physics. And in the case of energetic explosions, is the explosion energy of 10 to the 50 second waves. All ejecta except for inside of the mass is a dead force. So in that case, nuclear 56 about 1 to 2 solar masses also a dead force. So based on the result, we investigate the right bar like this. So this is the 100 solar mass model. And this is the period during the pulsation solar period. So we see the transient of physical precursors is a magnitude of minus 16. So this is the light of supernova. So red one is the small normal explosions and blue one is energetic explosions. So the, by the interaction of short cell and superconducta and the mass loss material, we see that the peak luminosity rate is around 10 to the minus 2 in the case of the 200 5 solar mass model, the peak luminosity is less luminous for supernova light bulb of 100 photons. So this is due to the longer period after the blast pulse and the world density. Next, I will show the 200 solar mass models. So precursor is shown 20 years ago, about 20 years ago, we were still the explorers. And peak luminosity is about 10 to 51, peak luminosity magnitude is about minus 21. So in that case, 456 decay is seen before the luminous event. So I will apply our result to the observation of superluminous supernova 1. So this is the figure for 140 solar mass model and 200 solar mass models. So typically, peak luminosity and decay time is roughly explained. And the variety of cobalt 66 power and the ratio of the distributions, we will see the variety of light bulb. And we also apply the optical transient of supernova 2006 DC. So this is observations and great reasonable in case the upper limit. So our result is not fine tuned. So the time scale and the amplitude is different. But the peak luminosity of the normal explosion is roughly consistent with observations. So amplitude. So we will see the multiple supernova outbursts like this. But what previous to the supernova explosion? So such a luminous events achieve superluminous supernova explosions. So if such a precursor of will be observed, this phenomenon could be captured with supernova outbursts. So, that's all. So this is our conclusion. Thank you very much.
Awesome, thank you. Questions? Far away from you as it could have been.
Do you have any expectations, or do you know of other works that have tried to model what the spectra of these things will look like? Will there be narrow lines, will there be broad lines?
So, sorry, I haven't, we haven't investigated.
For your methylene shell, you mean the velocity of the shell that already given the velocity? I don't know much about that. What's your definition of the methylene shell?
A methylene shell. Okay. Consortium means unbounded market.
So you have very massive star exploding inside, and I think usually people assume it would go to black hole. What's your compactness parameter of your progenitor, proxy progenitor, and you assume 1051 explosion, but can it be like less explosive? I mean, the explosion energy can be lower.
Your calculations. Explosion energy is determined by the kinetic energy of the ejector.
Yes.
Oh.
So, but you have compactness parameter and those parameters you can.
Okay. No, I have no question.
Okay, great. This thanks us to thank our speaker again.